and open up our Bibles to Genesis chapter 16. Genesis chapter 16. By the way, we want to welcome Bob and Dolores with us today. They saw the message on the internet this past week, and Patty's neighbors, Patty told them about New Hope, and so here they are this morning. Here they are this morning. Let's welcome them to our church this morning. Glad you're with us, Bob and Dolores. The title of my message today is Glance Backwards, Go Forward, and Gaze Upward. This is part one of a two-part message on this thrilling story embedded in the first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 16. I like to use the week before Christmas and New Year's to gain some needed perspective. And I usually gather together an inventory of thoughts, plans, and projects. Some I have completed, many more I have not completed, to tell you the truth. And I like to kind of get nostalgic this time of the year and recollect my life's journey from way back when, and then think about the future. I think about the friends that I have made over the years. I think about some of the friends that we've had at New Hope over the years that found the Lord here under the umbrella of New Hope, and they are in heaven today, and we can thank the good Lord for that. These exercises help me find meaning in my life's journey as I submit them for heaven's final approval. Many years ago, a wise family counselor, whose name is Norman H. Wright, told me in one of his seminars that I attended, "Dale," he said, "as you looked at me in the eyes, you will become the same person you are today, except for the people you meet, books you read, tapes you listen to, and the videos you watch." Then he said, "Dale, learn from people who are smarter and wiser than you are." And what he was saying to me actually was, "Dale, never stop learning." I remember when I graduated from Yakima Valley Junior College, I walked across the platform and shook the hands with the dean of the school, who told me in my freshman year that I was not college material, that I'd best find a trade and move on, and you're wasting our time and you're wasting your dad's money, is what he told me. And then my pastor gave me a pep talk, because I was flunking out of school. I was having fun. And the pastor pulled me to the side as he saw me walking back up the street after the dean gave me a lecture, and he said, "Dale, what's the problem?" And I said, "Well, pastor, I'm flunking out of school." He pulled that big old 1948 classic Buick off to the side of the road, and he said, "Dale, you're not dumb, but you're lazy." He said, "You hit the books." He said, "The answers are always in the books. And you go into the library after your classes are over, find a study partner, and you study together." So I took his advice. I'm glad I did. 2 years later, I shook the hand of that man who told me I wouldn't make it through. So there's always something to learn from people who are smarter than we are and wiser than we are. Those words were spoken to me 45 years ago, can you believe that? As I sat in his seminar, and that became a turning point in my spiritual and character development. I will always be grateful for Marianne's dad, who funded my journey and the expenses of that seminar when we were pastoring in Oklahoma to make the trip down to Dallas, Texas for that seminar. Glance backwards, go forward, gaze upward. Chapter 16 of the book of Genesis is an interesting story there. I enjoy reading the Old Testament stories. I learned these stories when I was just a kid growing up from our mother, who would always read out of Egemeyer's Bible storybook to us children. The story about Hagar. But you know, there was a man that was reading the newspaper one day, and he was looking through the obituary column, and can you imagine how surprised he was when he discovered his name was in it? So he went to the newspaper office, looked up the editor, and the editor of the newspaper could see that he was all upset, and he said, "What's the deal here? I'm still alive." And I was stunned to see my name in the obituary column. And the editor smiled and said, "Well, chill out. Just relax. I'll put your name in the new birth column tomorrow, and you can get a brand new start." We all love the idea of a brand new start, don't we? I can't think of a better time than to make a fresh, clean start at the beginning of a new year, especially 2020. And New Year's, for a lot of us, represents exactly that. We like to make a clean break from the past and move on with our life. But I've noticed that every time we go to a new year, you know what we say? We say the same thing over and over again. Every year we say, "Wow, where did the past year go? It went by so fast. And can you believe it? It's 2020 already. I don't believe it." We say that every stinking year, don't we? Where did the time go? It moves so fast. And it's true that as we age, it seems like time does go faster. Am I right on that? Can you say amen to that? And there's a reason for that, because I did a little research and discovered that we view time from two different perspectives. Two different perspectives. Either prospectively or retrospectively. Prospectively is viewing the time as you're going through an event. Retrospectively is you view time when it's all said and done, and you're looking back in the rearview mirror at that event. And our ability to remember the past largely depends upon these two vantage points. For example, when we're young or younger, there's a lot of firsts that we go through. And Reese is starting school tomorrow. At 8:30, a bus will roll into our driveway, and she will board that bus, can you believe that, and go to school. And Dad, Mom, and Grandpa, and Grandma will be out there in the driveway, and we will, as the bus leaves, taking her on her way to school. I remember the first day I went to school, my mom walked us out to the bus stop. We brown bagged it in those days, peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, and we boarded the bus and went to school. And in the first grade, I still remember it as though it were yesterday. We had hot lunch one day, and the cafeteria served on our plate baked beans. I mean, they were baked. They were awful. And I refused to eat them, and I got scolded by my first grade teacher, whose name was Miss Graham. And to this day, I have a hard time eating baked beans because of that bad experience. But we remember all the firsts in our lives. I really enjoyed visiting people during the week. And this past Thursday afternoon, I was in the home of Max and Julie. By the way, Julie had back surgery Friday. And you can tell just by the way she walks and the way she looks, she looks a lot freer of pain than she did previously. And she is in church today, and Max by her side. And so I was over there in their home Thursday afternoon and just kind of chatting. Then we had a word of prayer for her surgery. And then I said, I told Max and Julie, there's one chapter in your courtship that I don't think I know about. And how did you first make eye contact with Julie? And Max told me that story, and I was double over with laughter. It was so funny. And then he told me how he married her on leave from the army, stationed in Germany. And here's Julie, minding home business in Missouri in her comfort zone. Marries a soldier, he's stationed in Germany, and then he calls for her to come to Germany. And so Julie uproots herself out of that comfort zone, leaves home, travels all the way to the New York airport, boards another plane to Denmark, and then on into Germany, where she meets her new husband. And when she got off the plane, believe me, Max didn't recognize her. It was cold in Germany. She got a new haircut, and he didn't recognize her. But we're so thankful for Max and Julie. I love these stories of our people at New Hope. And so they've been married for 62 years. And so let's give them a hand of appreciation for their faithfulness. I remember my first date. You probably remember your first date. You may have hated it or you may have liked it, but we remember that first date. Very memorable. I remember the very first birth of our first child, Rebecca Lynn. Man, what a beautiful little baby she was. Brought her home from the hospital. Bassinet was by mom's side. And every once in a while, I would wake Marianne up and I'd say, why don't you reach over and poke her to make sure she's still breathing? Well, she's in her 50s now and a wonderful mother and grandmother, very gifted communicator as well. And so we remember these unique experiences, and our ability to remember them or have a vivid memory of that time largely depends upon how we look at that time yesterday. And I do that every time of the year, this time of the year. And so looking at both these ways, it sometimes has an illusion, because the older we get, time goes by a lot faster. And there's another factor in it. If you are enjoying the experience, or you're not enjoying the experience. If you're not enjoying the experience, then time drags, right? But if you are enjoying the experience, then you're having fun. You've heard it said, the old saying that goes something like this, time flies when you are having. I add two more words to that. Time flies when you are having fun, fun, fun. Time really flies then. Good time to have fun. That's true. Time does fly by very quickly. I've seen more sunsets than I will see sunrises. And we are at the beginning of a new year, a new decade. And we look back, where in the world did 2019 go? And here we are, first Sunday in January. Do you remember the church service we had exactly on this day, the first Sunday of 2019? Snow covered the grounds. Power went out. And we had church without any electricity. Remember that day? Just 1 year ago. I'll take the rain over the snow any day, won't you? But in our culture, every January, January 1, begins the rotation of the earth around the sun. That takes 365 and a third days, or exactly 8,765.8 hours. That's how much unspent time we have on our hands today. Some of us have already filled our calendars in for the year. Some of us have already scheduled appointments. Some of us have already made plans for this year. But I discovered that counting time is not nearly as important as making time. So how do we live these 8,000 plus hours? What decisions do we make? What a vantage point do we enter into this new year? Well, there's a question in our text that I'm going to draw your attention to this morning. There's Reese, picture taken with her backpack on, all set for her first day in school. The angel of the Lord appeared unto Hagar, and he asked her the question, "Where have you come from?" It's the question that this angel of the Lord asked this woman, who was an Egyptian girl. "Where have you come from?" was the first question. The second question was, "Where are you going?" Two very important questions, even for us to ask ourselves today. Where have we come from, and where are we going? So the angel of the Lord asked Hagar these two questions in the same sentence. Where have you come from? And next week we'll talk about where are you going? And I will add a third question based upon the revelation that this angel of the Lord gave Hagar. So, where have you come from? Where are you going? And what can you expect in 2020? These are the three questions that we're going to answer, one today, the next two next week. Now, beginning in Genesis chapter 16, verse 1, here's what it says. Now, Sarai, Abram's wife, her name will be called Sarah later on. Now, Sarai, Abram's wife, had borne him no children, and she had an Egyptian maidservant whose name was Hagar. And so Sarai said to Abram, "See now, the Lord has restrained me from bearing children. Please go into my maid, and I shall obtain children by her." And Abram heeded the voice of Sarai. Then Sarai, Abram's wife, took Hagar, her maid, the Egyptian, and gave her to her husband, Abram, to be his wife after Abram had dwelt 10 years in the land of Canaan. So he went into Hagar, and she conceived. And when she saw that she had conceived, her mistress became despised in her eyes. Then Sarai said to Abram, "My wrong be upon you, mister." It was a rough day in Abram's home that day, I tell you. "My wrong be upon you. I gave my maid into your embrace, and when she saw that she had conceived, I became despised in her eyes. The Lord judge between me and you." Abram said to Sarai, "Indeed, your maid is in your hand. Do to her as you please." And when Sarai dealt harshly with her, she fled from her presence. She ran away from home. Now the angel of the Lord found her by a spring of water in the wilderness. And by this spring on the way to Shur, he said, "Hagar, Sarai's maid." Here she sits, probably drinking some cool water from that well. The angel of the Lord shows up. "Hagar, where have you come from?" Second question. "And where are you going?" She said, "I am fleeing from the presence of my mistress." So you get the picture? Get the drift of the story? Hagar, the Egyptian servant of Sarai, she was sort of an innocent bystander. As a matter of fact, Hagar was the victim of Sarai, who was skilled in manipulation. Sarai had been told by the Lord she's going to have a baby. Hasn't happened yet. So Sarai figures, you know what? I think I will just kind of help God out a little bit. And I will help God perform what he said he would do. And I will use this Egyptian girl to be a surrogate mother. And we will call that the fulfillment of the promise. So Abram goes along with it. Hagar goes along with it. And she gets pregnant. Then there's the confrontation between Sarai and Hagar. It got so heated, I imagine, Hagar decided, enough of this. She packs her bags. She's out of there. She runs away from home. There's a whole story here and how to deal with runaway children. They're by the thousands. in our country today can't stand it at home anymore, and they leave home. Go back to Hagar. The angel of the Lord says, "Where have you come from?" She can answer that question. She says, "I am running away from home. I can't take the heat anymore there," paraphrasing. Then the angel asks the second question, "Well, Hagar, where are you going?" She didn't have a clue as to where she was going at this point in the story. She hadn't thought about that. She just ran away from home. Here she is sitting in the desert, in the middle of the open field, by a well, getting refreshment, waiting for the next step. So she's a runaway. Verse 9, the angel of the Lord said to her, "Listen up, Hagar," paraphrasing again, "return to your mistress and submit yourself under her hand." Notice that word there, submit. There's very, very few, let me say it this way, this is one of the hardest lessons for us to learn. Would you agree? Learning to submit to authority that's over us. If these Jehus, who were pulled over by the policeman, and if they would submit to the authority of the man or woman wearing that uniform, we wouldn't have policemen being shot today like they are. Somewhere along the line with these kids growing up, they have failed to learn the important lesson of learning to submit to those who are in authority over us. And so, submit yourself under her hand, the angel of the Lord said to her. And look what he said, "I will multiply your descendants exceedingly so that they shall not be counted for a multitude." And the angel of the Lord said to her, "Behold, you are with child. You're pregnant. And you're going to bear a son. And listen to this. You will call his name Ishmael because the Lord has heard your affliction." Now get this. This is right out of the Bible. "He shall be a wild man. His hand shall be against every man, and every man's hand against him. And he shall dwell in the presence of all his brethren." Folks, the chaos that we are seeing in the Middle East today got started all the way back there when Sarai took matters into her own hands and tried to help God out. I got news for people. God doesn't need any of our help except yes, yes, Lord, yes. That's all that he needs to hear from us. Then she called the name of the Lord who spoke to her. "You are the God who sees." For she said, "Have I also seen him who sees me?" There we are given the name of the well. And the angel of the Lord spoke to her and asked her those two questions. So Hagar bore Abram a son. And Abram named his son whom Hagar bore Ishmael. And Abram was 86 years old when Hagar bore Ishmael to Abram. Now, just a note that sometimes God asks the question. It's kind of weird when you think about it that God is asking questions. I can assure you and me that God isn't asking us questions to get schooled on. It's not like God needs information and he's going to get it from a person that he created. God asks the question typically to jog memory or experiences of the person that he's asking the question to. And here, there is an interrogation meant to store up a contemplation that will lead to a transformation in this girl's life and heart. God wanted to change this woman's heart and the way that she sees life. Guess what? God wants to change your heart. God wants to change my heart so that we can see life the way God sees life. We sing that song quite often, "Change My Heart, O God." That's what God wanted to do with Hagar. So, where have you come from? Now, asking that question was designed to get Hagar to identify her past. Now, notice what she says. After the angel said, "Where have you come from? Where are you going?" She said, "I am fleeing from the presence of my mistress, Sarai." Verse 8. She's become a runaway. Running away from our problems never solves the problem. It only complicates the problem. We need to face our problems. If we can't solve them ourselves, we look for good counsel. Who's smarter and wiser than we are, and ask some advice. We can't run from our problems, because no matter where you go, there you are. So she's called to look back from where she came from, to get in touch with that experience that she endured of pain, misunderstanding, a victim of manipulation and oppression. And she says, "I'm running away from home. I'm leaving. I've had it. All that mess. I'm running away from it." Now, usually when you tell someone to look backward, when you're trying to motivate them to go forward, there's not a very good idea to explore. But looking back is healthy if it's a glance backward. So we glance backward, not gaze, glance backward in order to go forward means that we quickly get our bearings and our orientation and just make sure we're not running around in circles doing the same thing over and over again and making the same mistakes over and over again. So as you glance back over this past year, 2019, push the replay button. Take a snapshot of your experiences and the events that you went through in 2019. What was it like? I can answer that for you. I bet it was a mixed bag. I bet there were some good times, and there were some not so good times. I bet there were some great times, and I bet there were not some so great times. I bet there were times of encouragement, and I bet there were some times of discouragement. I can imagine as we take a snapshot of 2019, we see some ups, we see some downs. It's a mixed bag. Am I right? Say amen. So, have you looked over your past year as you glance back? As you glance back, you will get a bearing on where you have been so we can make progress as we move forward. Now, as we look back, we will inevitably see man's faithlessness. As we journey through this life, we will run into people we think are friends, but we find out as time moves on that they really weren't that good of a friend. They become faithlessness. And at the same time, as we look back, we can count on God's utter faithfulness to us. I like Romans 8:28. We know that all things work together for good that love God and are called according to His purposes. And so, it's a good question to ponder. Where have you come from? Because different people will answer that question in a variety of ways. Now, some people will answer that question literally, geographically. Where have you come from? Well, I can tell you where I came from. I came from Texas. I came from Colorado. I came from Oklahoma, whatever state. And now I'm in this state, and things haven't happened the way I thought they should happen, and I end up blaming the state in which I'm living in. It's the state's fault, we say. Ever since I've been in this state, things haven't worked out for me. Well, Paul said, I have learned in whatever state I am in to be content. Hang your hat on that verse. Or some people might answer this question relationally. Well, tell you the truth, I've come from a broken home, come from a broken marriage, I've come from a strained relationship, and emotionally, I have come from a difficult situation. That's how some people will answer that question. Others are going to answer that question in a medical way. Well, taking a snapshot of 2019, I lost track of the number of times I have been in the doctor's office or on the operating table. And things really haven't looked that rosy to me. That's where I came from, some say. So here's the big question. Will you let God be the God of your past? Will you allow God to be the God of where you've come from, to help us sort through the rubble of the past year and use those bad times in some way for God to turn them around and make something good out of that bad experience? So once you glance to the past, you make a pivot, you start looking toward the future. The glance helps the going forward, and that's important. If a person wants to be miserable in 2020, that's their choice. And this is how you do it. Spend the rest of your year looking back over your shoulder, swimming in the sea of regret, and you'll end up finding 2020 pretty miserable. I like what Gary Chapman said. He said, I am amazed by how many individuals mess up every new day with yesterday. They insist on bringing into today the failures of yesterday, and in doing so, pollute a potentially wonderful day. So, Paul says in Philippians 3:13, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth to those things which are before, I press forward to the mark of the gospel of the high calling in Jesus. Now, when he says we need to forget the past, doesn't mean that we don't forget it. It just simply means that we are not to dwell on the past. Don't let the past control your presence today. Don't let the past so influence your presence that it paralyzes you. That's why we just need to glance backwards as we go forward. If there's one person that I can think of in Scripture that embodies this principle, then the best way is a guy by the name of Joseph. Joseph had one bad thing after another happen to him. He was sold by his brothers to the Midianites, who took him to Egypt. This guy, wearing the coat of many colors, was rejected by his brothers. He became a slave in Potiphar's house. Then he became a prisoner in Pharaoh's prison. He had one bad turn after another. Things turned against him. But eventually he became prime minister. You know the story. You remember his reaction when the brothers who betrayed him stood before him, hungry? Joseph had the power to seek revenge. Okay, you guys, I remember what you did to me way back then. Now you're in for it. He didn't do that. Remember what he said. It's a Genesis 50-20 principle. He said, as for you, you meant this for evil, but God meant it for good, to save, as it were, many people alive this day. I know what you had in mind, but I'm not going to allow that past experience to control who I am and where I'm going today. And I'm not going to let that bad experience influence my presence today. Thrilling story. So I got a question for you. Taking a page out of Joseph's book, Will you allow God to be the God of where you have come from, allowing Him to use the rubble and pain for good? That's the question. There's a great story about Thomas Edison. In 1914, his shop burned to the ground. He lost everything. His laboratory was burned. It was December 1914, by the way. And the next day, Thomas Edison was walking through the rubble of his burned down laboratory. And you would think that would devastate him. But as he's walking through, he turns to one of his assistants. And he had a smile on his face. And he said, "You know what? There's great value in destruction." He went on to say, "All your mistakes are burned up." That's a good perspective on a bad experience. All the mistakes I've made that people don't know about, they'll never know about it now. It's all burned up. So, glancing backwards, moving forward, gazing upwards. Every year at this time, I remember this for 33 years. It was 33 years ago, 1987, in December of the preceding year, I found myself at that time, I have no idea what it's like now, but at that time, it was a troubled church. And the senior pastor left. I'd been there 5 years as an assistant, and I told the board of trustees that I've seen enough of the roadway sitting behind the steering wheel of U-Haul. I've been here 5 years. You know me, I know you. And so I would like to be a candidate to become the pastor of this church. Really, he hawed around about it. And they finally decided to take a vote. He called me up, chairman did. He said, "Well, we have taken a vote, and it's unanimous." I said, was that the first vote or the second vote that you took? He said, "Well, how come you asked that question?" I said, "Well, I've been around the block a few times." Long story short, three of those five board members voted for me to be ratified by the congregation, but once they got out into the congregation and took the congregational vote, they voted against me. Sheer form of hypocrisy. And so I went back to that board, January 1987. I said, "If you'll give me the same severance package you gave the senior pastor, I'll pack my bags, clean out my office, I'm out of here." "We can do that for you, Pastor Dale." And so I lifted anchor of my old denomination in January of 1987, not having a clue as to where I was going to go or what I was going to do. I had a family to feed and to support. I was a little anxious, to say the least. I made good friends with a pastor down at New Hope, Community Church at that time. His name was Dale Galloway. He's no longer there. I told him about my experiences, and you know what he told me? He said, "Why don't you start a new church?" I said, "You gotta be kidding, I've never done that before." He says, "We will help you. We'll be your prayer support." That's more help than I got from my old denomination. I said, "Well, to start matters off, I like your name, New Hope. Can I have that one?" He said, "It's yours." And so we called this church in 1987, New Hope Christian Fellowship. It's to be a Christian church, and it's to be a fellowship. Healing hurts and building dreams has become our theme over all these years. And New Hope was born in a moment in my heart when I was grieving and I was hurting. I can identify with people who have a broken heart. And so I said in those years, January 1987, "God will lead us to people whose faces we have not seen, whose names we do not know, will like what we are trying to do, and will walk with us." New Hope has become a halfway house, so to speak, for people over these years. We've helped a lot of people. Some are in heaven now. And one of the things that we said we would not do, and that is we would not take an offering. And we have never taken an offering in this church. There's a beautifully built offering box on that back table. People can give their tithes and their offerings to us as they feel so led. And God has kept this church, New Hope, afloat for 33, going on 33 years. I say, give God the glory. And thinking that we have been eyewitnesses to lives being changed by that Holy Spirit. So I remember when we left, again, I'm going back, I'm glancing back. The year was 1973. And Mary Ann and I had pastored a church in the wheat country up in Mansfield in eastern Washington for 5 years. We felt it was time to move on. Our last Sunday there, I will always remember it. When we came to that church to candidate, we only had one vote against us. And that woman's name was Colleen. And she was a sophisticated woman. You know what I'm trying to say? And anyway, she voted against us. But she hung around and we became friends. And it got to the point where it was time for her to be baptized. And she said, Dale, you will never dunk me in that tank. That's exactly what she called it. I said, well, let's just see what the Lord will do with your life. Long story short, she was baptized. She became a very faithful church member and a very faithful friend. The last Sunday that we were in church, there was an emotional scene. We were saying goodbye and moving on. Some we will never see again in our lifetime. And Colleen wanted to sing a song. She had a beautiful voice. And so she sang a song in 1973, our last service there at Mansfield. And that song has stuck with me all of these years. Every time I hear it sung, I get emotional when I look at God's faithfulness. I want to share with you a promise from our good Lord that as we embark upon 2020, God, He will take care of you. You can go to the bank on that. Here I am, 78. I thought I was 77 all last year. I'm 78. Can you believe that? All these years, that song has resonated in my heart. God will take care of you. It's true. I want you to listen to the Oak Ridge Boys sing it.
I will celebrate, sing unto the